verse 19 onwards. And there we read that the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." And so this was a meeting apparently behind locked doors. Does this mean that Jesus opened the doors and entered among them? Or does it mean that suddenly he was simply there, manifested in the body among his people? I think it means the latter. Following the resurrection, it's clear that our Lord's body was invested with new properties. It was not restricted by the laws which controlled it before. And it seems that quite abruptly, suddenly, there was Jesus standing among them. The disciples were startled and frightened, thinking they had seen a spirit. I think we can sympathize with them. We can understand that it was something which took them completely aback. They had been meeting in a place that they thought was secure from intrusion, and suddenly there is Jesus among them. They had already begun to believe the testimonies of those who had seen Jesus, and yet they had not expected this. They had not expected something so different from their previous experience of him. Previously, Jesus had never appeared in this way, suddenly, out of the blue, behind locked doors, and so on. And they were startled and afraid, and they thought that they were seeing a ghost. Jesus spoke to them, "Why are you troubled? Look at my hands, look at my feet. See that it really is me. Handle me, and you will see that I am no ghost. A spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you can see that I have." And he showed to them his hands with the wounds of the nails. He showed to them his feet with the wounds of the nails. And they were overjoyed. And yet, for a time they continued now to disbelieve for joy, says Luke. It seemed as if this was too good to be true. Could it be that they were dreaming? Were they hallucinating? Was this really, really happening? And Jesus asked them, "Do you have any food here?" And they produced a piece of broiled fish, and they gave it to him, and the Lord Jesus ate it in their presence. And they were persuaded that this was indeed the Lord himself. This was the first of what Luke elsewhere describes in Acts chapter 1 as many infallible proofs. To the apostles, he presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs. They were left in no doubt at all that Jesus was alive, and that in the same body in which he had been crucified. It was a body which still bore the marks of the crucifixion. It was a body that they could touch and handle. It was a body which could eat and digest physical food. Moreover, they were left in no doubt that the personality of the Lord was unchanged. Still, he comes to bless them with his peace. Peace be to you. Still he comes mildly, gently, tenderly to rebuke their doubts and their fears. Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? And he comes graciously to remove those doubts by his words and by his actions. And so they are left in no doubt at all that the Lord whom they have known has been raised from the dead in all the reality of his human nature. Body, soul, and spirit, our Lord had been raised from the dead. Just as the incarnation was real, Jesus did not simply assume the appearance of a man, the outward form of humanity looking like a man. He became flesh and blood. He was born of Mary's substance, born a real human child, growing up to be a real human man. And just as the incarnation was real, similarly, the resurrection of Jesus was real. He was resurrected in all his humanity. And so we are reminded that the incarnation is something permanent. When Jesus took upon himself a body, a human mind, a human soul, human emotions, when he became man, he became man forever. It is not something which he laid aside at his physical death. That humanity was taken and resurrected in the resurrection and taken up to heaven on high. The whole message of the book of Hebrews is that we have a great high priest. The priesthood in Israel, one of the characteristics was that the priest was taken from among men. He was to be a representative of the people before God, one who could sympathize with the weaknesses of the people. And our Lord, in going to heaven as our great high priest, he goes as our representative. He is a man in heaven in the presence of God. The Apostle Paul, 1 Timothy 2 verse 5, he says there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. We need to emphasize this here in the Philippines. There are many here in our nation who think that they must go to God through Mary. Why do they want to go to God through Mary? Ah, they say, because Mary is so loving. Mary is so gracious. Mary is so understanding. Mary is so human. But the Bible tells us that we are to go to God through Christ. The Bible tells us that he is loving, that he is gracious, that he is understanding, that he is human. He has been tempted in all points, just as we are, yet without sin. And as our head and representative in his humanity, he has borne the judgment upon our sins on the cross of Calvary. And now he presents himself before the Father on behalf of all for whom he died, all who come to God by him. And in his glorified humanity, he has been given all authority in heaven and on earth. He has been given